Okay. Good afternoon to everyone. Today we will start a new practical class that is in continuation with our previous classes. So we will discuss about laboratory diagnosis of bacterial diseases. So bacterial diseases, or you can say when you are targeting some other infectious disease, then your method will be different from the starting. So here we will try to concentrate on diagnosis of various bacterial diseases. So in nutshell, I will brief you about sample collection, preservation, and what we learned in previous 2-3 slides. Then we will move towards the first family of gram-positive bacteria, that is Staphylococcus. So in the last class, you might have learned about this thing, that how we can diagnose any bacterial disease. So generally the steps as follow like this. The first and important step, that is selection. Selection, what I mean that you have to differentiate, or the clinician has to differentiate in the field, whether animal is really sick, that really required a laboratory diagnosis or not. Once you are telling that okay, animal is sick and that required some laboratory diagnosis or aid of laboratory diagnosis, then second important step, that is sample collection. So now when we are talking about sample collection, the important is which sample you will collect, when you will collect, because there is appropriate time to collect the sample. Even site is also important, that for collection of sample. Then how you will collect, the method by which you can collect, the amount you will collect. So all these parameters are important when you are going to, when you are planning to collect the sample for laboratory diagnosis. So this parameter you have to keep in mind, and these parameters varies from bacteria to bacteria, or you can say group to group. So if some bacteria are targeting digestive tract, then definitely your sample might be a fecal sample. But if it is targeting a respiratory system, then definitely your target sample is accordingly there. After collection, the next important step, that is a label. Generally, many times we are missing or we are not appropriately labeling the collected sample. So that will misguide the laboratory. So labeling, that is important, and it must enclose appropriate data which are required by laboratory to take any decision. Sometimes it may be possible that you have to add some preservative when you are targeting to send your sample to distance laboratory. Then appropriate preservative in appropriate concentration you have to add in your sample, and that you have to mention over the label. And the last, that is transportation. The thumb rule of transportation is try to transport your sample as early as possible after collection to your target laboratory, and always try to maintain the low temperature, that is 4 degrees centigrade. Once it will reach to laboratory, they will start the processing of sample, and after processing, you will get the result after some time. So this is what I tried to highlight, that how entire processes work. So here the field doctor is in contact with the laboratory person via transportation and logistic means. So if we have this entire logistic is very smooth, then we can give the correct result within a shortest time. Now we can see that next, that is what we learned till now. So the previous practical classes, they we took, or they there we learned about bacteriology in general. So now we will utilize that knowledge for isolation and confirmation of specific families or group of bacteria. So what till now we learned, that is that sample collection and transportation, that followed by laboratory preparation. So basic laboratory preparation might have covered about the washing of new glassware, reused glassware, how you can sterilize the different apparatus, how you can operate the equipments, laboratory equipments, how you can disinfect, various places, even your hand. Then you had also learned about the media preparation, then what broth preparation, how you can check their qualities. So all these are the important as a part of laboratory preparation. and that you have to routinely perform whether you receive samples or not. After this, I had discussed about different staining methods, that is primary, secondary, and tertiary, their importance and how we can perform these methods. What are the results that we had discussed in depth in those classes. Then we had also covered about the isolation of bacteria. So whatever primary isolation that must be followed by secondary isolation to get the pure culture, the different method of obtaining pure culture and the importance of pure culture. Later on, we had also seen various bacterial morphology and colony morphology. So different bacterial morphology, their arrangement, shape, size, that we can visualize after staining. And colony morphology we can see or we can realize after growing in particular media. Then presumptive diagnosis, that is performed by biochemical test. So various battery of tests we need to perform to ascertain or to confirm our presumptive diagnosis. And to achieve a definitive diagnosis, we may rely on molecular test and some extent to serological test. So this is particularly required for isolation and confirmation of bacteria. Besides this, we had also learned about AST, that is antibiotic sensitivity test. So that will tell us about which drug is sensitive to that particular isolate. Then we had also seen in brief about the preservation of bacteria. So if you have some good important isolate that need to be preserved for future or to perform some advanced studies or advanced tests, so that required to preserve for longer duration. So in brief, what I mean to tell that in the general bacteriology, we had studied all these techniques. Now we have to move to the systematic bacteriology. So your theory part is already started and gram positive, many families were covered. So now we will follow one by one family that what are the importance and how we can diagnose that particular bacteria from particular sample. So you can see that before reaching to that diagnosis of particular family of bacteria, here I had narrated or I had put up the point for the diagnostic part of infectious disease in general. So invariably question may ask in your exam that you have to write that morphology and pathogenesis, diagnosis and control of particular virus or bacteria or some other family. So you have to keep in mind, this is the general point. If you don't know anything and the examiner had asked about diagnosis, then you can definitely write this this point. Now, inside this point, the material may vary. For example, if media, then media, it vary for gram-positive bacteria, gram-negative bacteria. So it depends on what question they had asked, but the structure will remain same. So those students who cannot write in length, they can at least write this much thing. So in brief, first and foremost thing that you have to write about the clinical sign, lesion and history. So if they had asked about rabies, then you might have history about dog bite. You might have some important clinical signs and lesion. You might have learned about pathognomic lesion. So by seeing the pathognomic lesion, you can invariably or undoubtedly you can say that this particular case is of this bacteria or virus. Then second point, that is RDT, LF, PST, this is rapid test or lateral flow assay, this is known as pan site test. So in brief, these are the quickest tests that can be performed on the field and that does not require any expertization. For example, pregnancy diagnosis kit in human, that does not require gynecologist. Even that lady can herself perform that test. So such tests are available for many diseases and they can be easily used by the farmer by themselves. The only difficulty is that they have poor sensitivity. Sometimes they may cross-react, and it is not available for all the diseases. The third, that is direct microscopy. So third diagnostic point is whenever you are collecting sample and or you receive sample from field veterinarians in your laboratory, then first and foremost thing you have to go for direct staining. So you have to prepare the appropriate smear, fix it, and go for gram staining or any other appropriate staining. See whether an organism is present or not. If microorganism or bacteria present, then note down the morphology, their amount and their characteristic. So that will ultimately help us to correlate your findings. So this is considered as important in many cases, and particularly in postmortem cases, you require to take impressions near from organs. So that will also help for presumptive diagnosis or for early diagnosis of your samples. Then fourth, and most commonly this is performed for bacteria, but it is difficult for virus, that is isolation and confirmation of etiology. Generally in bacteria, required to isolate bacteria in pure culture, and later on we have to confirm this bacteria based on bacterial morphology by performing staining, observing shape, size and arrangement. Later on we can also observe the colony morphology. Many bacteria have typical bacterial colony on specific media, so you should remember the media and their colony characteristic. After that you can also perform a battery of biochemical tests that will help us to differentiate closely related bacteria. And for definitive diagnosis, you may rely on some molecular test like PCR. So this is very easy to perform in case of bacteria, but isolation and confirmation is difficult in viruses. But then also isolation is considered as a gold standard test for diagnosis of most of the infectious diseases. Besides this, serological test has also their own importance. A serological test like ELISA and all this can be performed in laboratory for specific diagnosis of diseases. But here the limitation is you cannot directly show the presence of antigen. This is an indirect way of telling that a particular animal is suffered or was suffered from particular disease. And serological test, for serological test, you required a serum. So most of time you have to collect the serum. So timing of serum collection after onset of clinical disease is important. So that's why sometimes you require paired serum sample to give the definitive diagnosis. Later on, some molecular tests. So nowadays you can say many laboratories and many clinicians are rely on molecular tests because that gives a definitive diagnosis, undoubtful diagnosis for particular diseases. But the disadvantage of molecular test is that is a costly and that require expertization as well as some sophisticated instrument. Some infectious condition where you may diagnose or you may confirm your diagnosis by animal inoculation. For example, in lab animal like rat and animal, you can inoculate your bacteria, unknown bacterial culture, and based on some clinical symptoms or re-isolation and reconfirmation of that organism, you can confirm the etiology of some of the samples. Very few samples, they are produced the toxin, and for those bacteria and those microbial agent, the indirect way of showing the presence of that particular bacteria is demonstration of toxins. And toxins can be demonstrated by in vitro study or in vivo study, like the toxin neutralization test. So these are in brief or in general about the topics for diagnosis of any infectious disease. So in exam, you can take help of this topic, and based on your target organism, you can fill up the detailed material under this topic. Now, this is in general about general diagnosis. Now we will move towards the first family of gram-positive bacteria, that is Staphylococcus. So before starting this one, you should be aware that microbes, that is one big class. Under microbes, we had divided bacteria, viruses, then fungi, then intermediate bacteria in different group. So under bacteria, there are two important class, that is gram-positive bacteria and gram-negative bacteria. There are some books or some chapters, they are considered intermediate group of bacteria. So you can consider as a three type. So first in theory started, that is about gram-positive bacteria. So under gram-positive bacteria, Staphylococcus we will start in today's class, and later on we will go on to add up other gram positive bacteria, and in those classes we will try to differentiate what we have learned in our class. Okay, so today we will see about basic about Staphylococcus practical. So in this class, the objective of today's class is what disease is caused by Staphylococcus, what type of sample we need to collect from that particular disease condition. Sample collection transportation is invariably important. So you should concentrate on what sample you have to collect, because that is considered as a half of your test. Okay, and the result is entirely depend on how best your sample was collected and sent to your laboratory. We will see then direct microscopy, what are the features of Staphylococcus. And on the last 4-5 slides, I will try to give about the different isolation method, their characteristic, and how we can confirm this particular isolate. So we can see disease. So generally this is covered in your practical theory class, but then also I have tried to enlist in a tabular form, because this is also important for your theory exam. So you can see Staphylococcus aureus is the most important species under genus Staphylococci, and generally this is responsible for causing gangrenous mastitis. Besides gangrenous mastitis, it also causes some of important diseases in different domestic animal. And in exam also, the etiology of botryomycosis, bumblefoot, messy cheek disease, they are commonly asked in your exam. So you should remember that which organism in which species, what disease or clinical condition it causes. Some other species like intermediates that causes like this, okay. Then high cusp that cause greasy pig disease in pig. Then sick aureus, subspecies anaerobius that cause lymphadenitis. So in nutshell, what I want to tell that the subspecies or species that cause specific disease in particular host, and based on the clinical condition, based on that clinical condition, the target sample need to be collected. For example, if Staphylococcus aureus is causing mastitis in cattle, then we should collect the mastitic milk. That is the target sample for diagnosis of Staphylococcus aureus. Now, sometimes it causes abscess. So if that will cause the abscess, like in case of dog and cat that cause suppurative condition, so abscess. So in such cases, we require to collect the pus. For example, sometimes that will cause infection to skin, then you require the skin swab. So in nutshell, what I want to say that inside that particular family, this particular species has some specific target organ or target system. And based on clinical symptoms, your sample need to be collected. Once you will collect the sample, then you have to send to laboratory for further investigation. So the first thing, when it reaches to laboratory, the first and foremost thing, you can go for direct microscopy. So whatever sample reaches to your laboratory, for example, the field veterinarian has collected milk sample in mastitis case, then you have to go for direct microscopy in laboratory. And if it is a Staphylococcus, then you can observe like this. So Staphylococcus, they will observe like gram-positive cocci. Generally, they are present in bunch, and that's why they are peculiarly shown or seen as a bunch of grapes. So bunch of grapes, that is a arrangement of gram-positive cocci, and this is a characteristic of Staphylococcus. And generally, exam, they may ask that write the organism which has which shows or which looks like bunch of grapes. So this you have to remember. So this will give a presumptive diagnosis that your sample might contain Staphylococcus. Now you have to go for confirmation of that particular isolation. So for confirmation of Staphylococcus, so invariably for bacteriological or bacteria, we are going for isolation and confirmation. So isolation and confirmation of bacteria or Staphylococcus. So Staphylococcus required, or they have two peculiar characteristics. One, generally all the Staphylococcus are facultative anaerobes. They can grow in presence of oxygen. except these two exceptions. One, that is Staphylococcus aureus subspecies anaerobinus and Staphylococcus saprolyticus. These are the exceptions that they cannot grow in aerobic condition. They require anaerobic condition and they are catalase negative. So exception you have to remember from exam point of view. The second important characteristic of Staphylococcus, that is salt tolerant nature. Salt tolerant nature of this organism help them to survive in high concentration of salt. So that's why they can survive at around 7 to 8% of salt. And that's why the media that contain high salt may act as a selective media for Staphylococcus isolation. Many times in exam they may ask that write the name of salt loving bacteria. So as they can grow in high salt concentration, sometimes they are also referred as salt tolerant or salt loving bacteria. Now, different media are, because media is important for isolation of any bacteria. So choice of media is based on your target organ. For example, in Staphylococcus, we can grow this Staphylococcus in normal media, that is non-enriched media, that does not require enriched media because they are not fastidious. So if organism is fastidious, then they may require enriched media. So I hope you know that enriched media, enrichment media, selective media, differential media, that might have covered in your previous classes. So here they does not require enriched media. Simply you can aerobic incubation is sufficient. And overnight incubation at 37 degrees centigrade is optimum for getting growth of Staphylococcus. Now, if you are growing or isolating Staphylococcus in nutrient agar, it gives peculiar convex, circular, shining and opaque color. Sometimes in some book, they are also referred as drop of oil paint like color. So this is a characteristic of Staphylococcus. You can see in this picture, this is drop of oil paint, and that's why they are referred as peculiarity of Staphylococcus. Now the second peculiarity of this Staphylococcus is they are capable to produce pigment. So pigmentation is a second characteristic of Staphylococcus, and that vary from species to species. And many times that will help to differentiate species based on pigmentation. For example, a golden yellow pigmentation is a common feature of Staphylococcus aureus. So you can see that this figure that indicates the Staphylococcus aureus. Now here in bottom you can see this is a white color colonies. So this is entirely different and easily differentiable from golden yellow colony. And this is an indicative of white colony. This is a characteristic of Staphylococcus albus and Staphylococcal epidermis. So what I mean to say that based on color of colony or pigmentation of colony, you can differentiate some of genus of Staphylococcus. For example, Staphylococcus citrus. So citrus generally indicate the lemon. Okay. So citrus, that is indicate of lemon, and that's why the pigment color of this citrus is lemon yellow color. You can see in this figure, okay, this is a lemon yellow color colonies, and this is a peculiar colonies or indicative colony of Staphylococcus citrus. Now there are two exceptions. One is Staphylococcus hicus and Staphylococcus intermedius. These two cannot produce pigment. So it is not definitive that it must produce pigment. But there are some Staphylococcus, they may not produce pigment, but still they may classify under the Staphylococcus. So this is the important criteria of this particular bacteria to differentiate important species like aureus, citrus and albus. Now, this is general about in isolation of bacteria. Now sometimes some enriched media or some selective media can be used for selective isolation or pure for obtaining pure culture. So generally the third characteristic of this organism, that is hemolysis. So hemolysis means, hemo means blood, lysis means that they are capable to lyse the RBC. So this peculiarity is indicated when you grow your target organism or Staphylococcus in blood agar. So generally blood agar that contain ox blood or sheep blood agar, they are used to see the hemolysis characteristic of Staphylococcus, and many times that may added with nalidixic acid and colistin to make them selective for Staphylococcus, because nalidixic acid that will prevent or inhibit the growth of protease, whereas colistin that will inhibit the growth of gram negative contaminant. So once you grow this Staphylococcus on blood agar, and on the next day you will observe for hemolysis, then hemolysis is classified in four important groups. One that is known as alpha, that is indicated by narrow zone of hemolysis around the colony. You can see here, this is a colony, and this is minor line, that is a clear hemolysis of RBC, that is considered a peculiarity of alpha hemolysis of Staphylococcus. Second, that is known as beta hemolysis. Beta hemolysis, that is comparatively wider zone, and that is usually partial hemolysis. So partial hemolysis, you can see here, this is around this one, and this is a wider zone and partial hemolysis. Now the gamma, there is indication of no hemolysis. You can say the colonies were there, but there is no hemolysis. That is gamma hemolysis. And the last delta, that is a complete hemolysis, means there is a more wider zone than the alpha. That is a complete hemolysis. So sometimes hemolysis that will also help to differentiate different species of Staphylococcus. Now there are two words, double hemolysis and hot cold hemolysis phenomena. Double hemolysis means there is a presence of two zone of hemolysis, that is alpha and beta at the same time. Hot cold hemolysis means you have to incubate your plate at 4 degrees centigrade to visualize the clear hemolysis. So that is known as hot cold hemolysis, and both were covered in depth in your theory class. The last that you have to remember, that there is one genus, that is Staphylococcus hicus, that does not produce any hemolytic nature. Okay, so you can say that is gamma hemolysis. Now the next, that is isolation on selective media. So two media you have to remember when we are talking about Staphylococcus. One that is known as BP agar, that is generally abbreviation of Baird Parker agar, and that will give the black jet colony. You can see easily appreciate in this figure, this is black colony, that is indicative of Staphylococcus. The second, you can grow on mannitol salt agar. Mannitol salt agar, because salt loving bacteria that require high salt, or they can grow in high salt concentration. And second, mannitol is used by many Staphylococcus. So once they will use, they will convert to yellow color colonies. Okay, so this is indication of utilization of mannitol and growth in presence of high salt. Now beside this one, for many times they may strike on McConkie agar, and there is no growth indicate positive for presence of Staphylococcus. But there are some species nowadays reported, they can grow and produce pink color colonies. So this is not confirmative for confirmation of Staphylococcus. Similar way, DNase agar can be used for confirmation of their DNase enzymes activity. Now further confirmation we can perform by employing various biochemical tests. So after isolation, we had seen their bacterial morphology, that they are gram positive, they are present in bunch, generally they are non sperm forming, there is no capsule. So this is a characteristic of bacteria. Then if you will see the characteristic of colony morphology, we had studied in previous slide. Then the one third important characteristic, that is they are non motile, they cannot they does not possess flagella, and they does not show motility in motile media. Now the fourth we can confirm by biochemical test, and bacteria biochemical test can be performed. The important biochemical test can be performed for diagnosis of Staphylococcus is KOH. So KOH is negative, because that will help us to differentiate gram positive from gram negative bacteria, and negative result indicate gram positive bacteria. The second catalyst that will help us by utilization of S2O2, and that will produce the bubbles. So if it is positive, that will indicate that they are the Staphylococcus, and if that is negative, that helps, or that will tell that it is Staphylococcus. So this particular test can be used to differentiate staphylococcus and streptococcus. The third, that is oxidase test. Generally, oxidase test is found negative in case of staphylococcus. The fourth, that is coagulase test. Coagulase test is generally employed in staphylococcus because many times staphylococcus are non-pathogen. So in order to tell that they are staphylococcus, we can correlate their virulence by demonstrating the coagulase test. So coagulase test can be performed in two, slide coagulation test or tube agglutination test. And this coagulation test indicate that this particular isolate is pathogenic or non-pathogenic. And the second last, that is sugar fermentation. Generally, this organism are capable to utilize the maltose. And that's why in market a purple agar is available that contain the maltose, and once it will utilize the maltose, that will demonstrated by change in color of the media. DNS agar, I had earlier told that DNS activity can be demonstrated, but it is variable, so it's not routinely performed to confirm the staphylococcus. Now we will move to the last question, that is toxin demonstration. Generally, this particular bacteria, they have some toxins like hemolysin, leukotoxin, enterotoxin and others. But it is difficult to demonstrate. For example, in case of Clostridium, it is mandatory to demonstrate the presence of toxins to confirm the etiology. But here it is, even though they produce some exotoxins, but it is difficult and it is not constantly produced and it is not easy to demonstrate. That's why generally it is not performed in case of staphylococcus. But the last point, for confirmation, for definitive identification, nowadays many clinicians and the laboratory, they relied on molecular test. And under molecular test, PCR and real-time PCR are most commonly performed to find out their genus, species, and sometimes they are also performed to demonstrate some virulence gene. So that will tell that particular isolate is of pathogenic nature or non-pathogenic nature. So this particular genus, species and virulence factor that vary from species to species and genus to genus. So that's why I have not delved in very depth. But you can write in nutshell about the target gene and the species. Now the last question, that there are many gram-positive cocci. They are giving similar morphology under gram staining. Now we require to differentiate them from others. For example, staphylococcus need to be differentiated from streptococcus, that is most closely related gram-positive organism. They also require to differentiate from enterococcus. They also require to differentiate from micrococcus. So in brief, this table will tell that how we can differentiate this. For example, if you are appearing or if you are seeing the slide after gram staining, then staphylococcus will give grapes like bunch. Whereas streptococcus and enterococcus, that will give the chains, okay? They might be short or long chain. But if they are present in the packets of 4 or 8 like tetra, then that is indicative of micrococcus. Similar way, if you are performing the coagulase test, then coagulase is only indicative of pathogenic staphylococci. They are not present in micrococcus and streptococcus. Similar with catalase, that is indication of staphylococcus and micrococcus, but it is negative for streptococcus. And that's why catalase is chiefly employed to differentiate staphylococcus from streptococcus. Similar way, oxidase is generally negative for staphylococcus and streptococcus, but oxidase is giving positive result for micrococcus. OF test, that is also a primary biochemical test, generally that will indicate oxidation fermentation reaction of particular bacteria. Generally staphylococcus and streptococcus, they are classified under fermentative nature, whereas micrococcus, that is classified under oxidative nature. So these two will help to differentiate staphylococcus and streptococcus from micrococcus. Okay. And last, that is susceptibility to bacitracin disc. So generally micrococcus, they are susceptible, whereas staphylo and strepto, they are resistant. So this is in brief about the gram positive cocci. They are how we can differentiate. Now as a part of your assignment, what you have to do is you have to enlist the different distinguishing features of important staphylococcus species. So species wise, you have to identify, you have to write the test and you have to write their result. So this is as a part of the assignment you have to complete. And second, that you have to write in different point by which you can differentiate staphylococcus from streptococcus. So this is in brief about today's class about diagnosis of staphylococcus. And if you have any query, then you can divert me on this number and email ID. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you, everyone.